Welcome back to our online course in health psychology. In this video, we're going to delve into people's responses to physical symptoms and their interactions with the healthcare system. Understanding these psychological processes is crucial for improving patient outcomes and enhancing the patient-provider relationship. So let's dive in. In the realm of healthcare, psychological processes significantly impact how individuals recognize and interpret symptoms and respond to diagnoses. Factors such as prior experiences, personality traits, culture, gender, internal and external factors all shape these responses. Additionally, the way an illness is represented, including its label, causes, time frame, consequences, and controllability, can greatly influence how people respond to symptoms. When it comes to seeking medical treatment, sociocultural and demographic factors play a role. The very young and the very elderly tend to access health services more frequently. Women, both adolescents and adults, often seek healthcare more than men due to various factors, including the fragmented nature of women's healthcare. Socioeconomic status and cultural influences also play an impact in an individual's decision to seek medical care. However, some individuals may delay seeking treatment due to not noticing symptoms, a denial of illness, or a belief that the costs outweigh the benefits. On the other hand, there are cases of overutilization of healthcare services, such as an illness anxiety disorder or malingering. Adherence, or closely following the advice of healthcare providers, is crucial for successful outcomes. Encouragingly, approximately 75%, so 3 out of 4, patients adhere to treatment regimens. Optimism, a positive mood, trust in the care provider, social support, perceived control for those who prefer it, a strong patient-provider relationship, and clear explanations of treatment regimens all contribute to improved adherence. A strong patient-provider relationship, in particular, plays a vital role in the success of medical treatment. Effective communication between patients and providers is essential, but often faces challenges. Time pressures in healthcare, the focus on medical training rather than social skills when selecting providers, and historical neglect of communication and medical education contribute to communication difficulties. Furthermore, institutionalized racism and discrimination in healthcare can have adverse effects on minority populations. Miscommunication can also arise from a difference in attitudes, gender, culture, and education levels between patients and providers. So, from the perspective of the provider, communication issues tend to be in the form of too little time, too much to do. That's why your appointments are 15-minute blocks and you speak with the provider and then they're out of there, okay? Communicating with the patient is also a struggle because this could lead to two ends of a communication spectrum, where on one end, you speak with far too much jargon, or the provider speaks with far too much jargon, and on the other end, they speak with far too much baby talk or childlike words, especially when speaking to an adult. Now, if they're a pediatrician and speaking with a child, then of course, childlike care and communication is important, but you can't speak to an adult like that. And as I said, racism and institutional bigotry is also a major problem. As we'll mention in a future video, artificial intelligence is helping doctors make treatment decisions. But because those treatment decisions were made by doctors, and then the AI is just putting them all together to give the new doctor and the new patient a treatment plan, the problem ends up being that the bigotry and the prejudice that existed previously is going to be carried through even with these new technologies. On the other hand, patient communication problems make it difficult for the provider to provide care. The main issue is that patients tend to come into the office unprepared to discuss what they want to discuss, instead really only focusing on the motivating symptom of pain. It hurts when I do this. Well, of course, don't do that and you won't feel pain. But obviously, that minimizes the patient's experience. And then when they're minimized, they shut down, they get more anxious, they don't want to learn. And there are a lot more issues that can become bigger if this is the type of communication. All right, so how do we do better? Well, one way is to increase health literacy, which is the ability to obtain and understand basic health information. Patients with low health literacy face challenges in accessing care, seeking preventative measures, adhering to treatment regimens, and making informed decisions. The internet and telemedicine offer opportunities for patients to become better consumers of health information, but careful consideration is needed to preserve the patient-provider relationship. Now, to end this video, I want to briefly discuss the U.S. healthcare system. And the U.S. healthcare system is based around hospitalization. Hospitalization is the primary way most people in this country seek medical care, whether through it's a doctor associated with a medical establishment or hospital, or through the emergency room. Hospitalization can often lead patients and participants feeling depersonalized because you're really just getting in and getting out, and you really don't have any control over treatment because, especially if you go to the emergency room, all of those providers are interested in reducing acute and severe issues as quickly as possible. However, interventions that provide informational control and employ cognitive behavioral techniques can positively impact patient adjustment. By empowering patients with knowledge and supporting their emotional well-being, hospitals can create a more patient-centered environment. Now, on the previous slide, you saw that healthcare delivery systems around the world vary with models including single provider, single payer, mandated insurance, and fee-for-service kinds of programs. In the United States, a pluralistic system combining different designs is in place. Rising costs, however, medical errors, and patient dissatisfaction are driving healthcare reform efforts. Patient-centered care aims to make patients active participants in their own healthcare, receiving services tailored to their individual needs and preferences. Accountable care organizations, ACOs, are a key component of healthcare reform under the Affordable Care Act, or the ACA, or Obamacare. ACOs bring together healthcare providers to deliver coordinated evidence-based care with accountability measured through quality metrics. Understanding people's responses to physical symptoms and their interactions with the healthcare system is crucial for promoting positive health outcomes. Remember, effective communication, patient empowerment, and a patient-centered approach are essential for delivering quality care. Thank you for joining us today, and we look forward to continuing our journey through the fascinating field of health psych. Keep exploring, stay curious. Until next time, try not to get to the emergency room. I'll see you in the final video.